heart health. Good heart health equals less cardiovascular disease, i.e. things like heart attacks and strokes. Most people are born with excellent heart health, but as we get older, things begin to change, and hormones are integral to that. Today, we're going to talk about diabetes and, in a more roundabout way, your sex hormones. But let's start here, a tiny organ behind your stomach called the pancreas. Your pancreas is amazing. It produces a ton of things, including a lot of your digestive enzymes. It also produces a hormone you've probably heard of called insulin, which is involved in the storage of sugar in your body. When you eat carbs, your body breaks that down into simple sugars like glucose, and glucose is really important for every single cell in your body. In fact, that's what respiration is. Without glucose, you're dead. But you don't want too much of it. That's a bad thing. Like everything, we don't want too much or too little, just the right amount. And what stops your glucose building up and up? Insulin. Insulin pushes those sugars into storage containers in your muscles, your liver, and your fat. When insulin doesn't work as well as it should, either because your body stops producing it or because your tissues become less responsive to it, that sugar builds up in your blood again, and that leads to diabetes, type 2 diabetes to be specific. Diabetes can be pretty nasty, and if it's not under control, it can cause a whole array of unpleasant things to happen to you. One of those things is cardiovascular disease because of the way it impacts your blood vessels. It's a major risk factor, so making sure your sugar is under control is a key element of low cardiovascular risk. And you can measure it. Despite what you might see some influencers do online, constantly measuring their insulin and glucose levels, that isn't really very useful. In fact, it's pretty pointless. But you know what? That's another video. Instead, we can look at your insulin in a more specific way with a fasting insulin resistance test. In that test, if your insulin is high when you're fasting, we can extrapolate that your body is producing more insulin than normal because it's not responding as well as it should to normal levels of insulin. Insulin resistance is a key factor in type 2 diabetes. Another thing we can do is look at the effect that insulin is having and whether it's doing its job of moving sugar into storage. We do this by measuring your sugar levels with a marker called HbA1c. That's glycated hemoglobin. Yeah, what's that? Well, your red blood cells mop up sugar that's floating around, and it does that irreversibly. It becomes glycated. Now, the average red blood cell lives about 3 to 4 months, so looking at your HbA1c gives us a pretty good idea of the amount of sugar that's been floating in your blood for the last 3 months or so. You can actually watch a fuller video all about that up there. Although diabetes is associated with a lot of bad things, there's one good thing about it, potentially. It's that it's reversible. It responds really well to lifestyle changes, things like diet and exercise. So if you, say, measure your HbA1c annually and you see things creeping up and up and up and up, you might want to make some lifestyle changes to see it coming down. That's altering your health trajectory completely and maybe stopping you having that heart attack in 20 years' time. That's preventative medicine. That's in your hands. That is awesome. So sugar is one thing you can keep an eye on with cardiovascular disease. The other thing is your cholesterol levels. Cholesterols are basically little bits of fat, and they make up every single cell in your body, so they're pretty important. They're transported around your body by things called lipoproteins, and these come in a variety of densities. You have high density ones and low density ones and some other ones in between. HDL is considered the good stuff. Think happy, H for happy. It takes cholesterol from your tissues to your liver, where you process it. LDL and non-HDL take cholesterol from your liver to your tissues and dump them in your blood vessels. If there's too much of that, it causes plaques of lipids to build up over time, which eventually block your blood vessels, and if that happens in your heart, it leads to a heart attack. So what you want to do is, as always, make sure you have the right balance. You don't want too much LDL and non-HDL, and you don't want too little HDL. Again, I've made a video about it up there if you want more detail. Now, what does this have to do with hormones? Well, funnily enough, we need to talk about your sex hormones. Both men and women produce estrogen and testosterone, but for men, we're going to focus on testosterone, and for women, estrogen. If you're a woman, you produce a bunch of estrogens, and there's a key one to look at called oestradiol. In premenopausal women, this can help keep cholesterol levels in check. So for most women, oestradiol is doing its job. However, if you've had a total hysterectomy, so your ovaries were removed as well as your womb, oestradiol is low. And that, along with some other reasons, is why hormone replacement therapy is recommended. Some contraceptive pills also lower your oestradiol levels, though not to the same extent. Female endurance athletes may also end up with low oestradiol levels from exercising too much. And interestingly, some athletes go on to have a higher cardiovascular risk in later life. More on that in the sports hormone video later. If you've been through the menopause, then things are far less clear. The evidence is not quite there yet, so I'm not going to touch on that today. Now, if you're a man and you have low testosterone, you might end up taking testosterone replacement therapy. Some strength trainers also take anabolic steroids. These can suppress your cholesterol levels and increase your bad cholesterol, which can in turn increase your cardiovascular risk significantly. In the case of people who take steroids, and there are a lot of people out there who do, it can significantly increase your cardiovascular risk. So keeping an eye on your hormones and other biomarkers is really important. But I guess this does raise the question, should we look to modify hormones? The answer to that is maybe, but it would have to be highly tailored and undertaken with specialist input. We often don't even need to do that because cardiovascular risk is made up of a lot of other things, not just hormones. And if your hormones are not quite balanced, it may persuade you to work on other elements of your lifestyle because lifestyle can impact your hormones too. Simple changes, well, I say simple, simple to say, maybe not so easy to do, but things like this. Get active. Walk every day if you can. And if you can do more, break a sweat 5 times a week, lift some weights at least 2 times per fortnight, and then you can improve your diet. Home-cooked whole foods. If you smoke, stop. If you drink, cut it down. And make sure your sleep is decent. That means 7+ hours of uninterrupted sleep per night. And of course, the most important thing you can do for your health, subscribe to this channel and drop a thumbs up. Stay healthy, stay happy. I'll see you in the next video. Bye-bye.